Welcome to lecture 22 of Mathematical Modeling and Simulation. In this lecture, we are going to look at random number generation and a particular method of doing that, linear congruential method. In our last lecture, we discussed what is a random number, what are true random numbers, and how do we generate true random numbers. And then we also discussed what are pseudo random numbers and what is pseudo random number generation. In short, it is called PRNG. And then we discussed one of the techniques of generating pseudo random numbers, and that technique is called mid-square algorithm. So now we are going to discuss another technique to generate pseudo random numbers, and this technique is called linear congruential method. This method was discovered by D.H. Lemmer in 1951. So I'll be explaining you its algorithm step by step. So just like in every PRNG, every pseudo random number generator algorithm, we start with a seed value. We have to start from a initial value, and then we have to write the iterative formula. So x naught be the seed value which we have to give. The formula is xn is a times xn minus 1 mod m. X1 is a times x0 mod m, x2 is a times x1 mod m, and so on. A is called the multiplier, and this iterative formula, which is basically our algorithm, this is called multiplicative LCG, means linear congruential generator. Originally, Lemmer used these values, a is 23, m equals to 10 raised to power 8 plus 1. So now we need to understand what does this method do actually. So as you can see, the formula is xn is axn minus 1 mod m. So basically, we'll just give the value of x naught. Then using x0, x1 will be computed, and then using x1, x2 will be computed, and so on. So in this way, we will be getting a generation of a sequence of random numbers. So all what we have to give is the seed value x0 and the multiplier a, and of course m. Now you should be already familiar with this mod function. So what is the meaning of this mod function? So it means what you have to do is first multiply. When you will be giving x0 as a seed value, you multiply with a, then whatever comes up, you have to divide with m, and the remainder of that is your x1. So mod m means divide with m and write the remainder as an answer. So the remainders you keep on writing and keep on multiplying with a at every step and divide by m. So that's why this is called a multiplicative linear congruential generator, because there is no form of addition or subtraction involved. It just involves multiplication with some number. So now let's just understand this with the help of an example. Let's take the formula again. Now I'll be giving you the specific values of the parameters. So in particularly, take x naught is 1, a is 2, m is 5. So sequence, now we need to write the sequence of random numbers using these values. So what you just have to do, substitute this in the formula and get the sequence. So x1 is 2 times x0, a is 2. So it's 2 times 1 means 2 mod 5, which is 2. Then x2 is 2 into 2 mod 5. So 4 mod 5 is 4. And x3 is 2 into 4 mod 5, which is 8. So 8 when divided by 5 leaves a remainder 3. X4 is 2 into 3 mod 5, which is 6 mod 5. So the remainder is 1. And then x5 is again 2 into 1 mod 5, which again gives you 2. So from this point onwards, the sequence will repeat itself. So we can say the period of this LCG, linear congruential generator algorithm, is 4, because after 4 values the sequence starts repeating itself. Because after 4 numbers, you can see the unique numbers which you are getting are 2, 4, 3, 1, and so it will keep on happening 2, 4, 3, 1, 2, 4, 3, 1. So it's just giving you 4 different random numbers. So that means this is not a good selection of numbers or parameters, you can say. So our controlling parameters are the seed value, x0, a and m. So if you do not choose them carefully, you'll end up having a very bad algorithm or a very bad output or a sequence of random numbers, because you're just getting 4 random numbers and that sequence is repeating itself. So in our last lecture, we discussed that the output of your random number generator algorithm should be like, it should be, the period should be as long as possible. Means the repetition or the cycling should not be there. So this is a very poor choice of the parameters. So now the question arises, how do we know that what is going to be a good choice of parameters? So since, because this formula involves the number theory, so it has the congruential relation, you are dividing and taking the modulus or getting the remainders. So you can apply many results from number theory to reach out some results which will help you to tell, take this value of A or M or seed value, so that you get a good sequence of random numbers. So that can be done, but before taking that, let me give you another generalization of the same method, linear congruential. So a generalization of multiplicative linear congruential generator to mixed LCG is this: xn is axn minus 1 plus b mod m. So where b is now responsible for the additive term. Earlier it was just multiplicative, now it is multiplicative and additive. That's why it's called mixed. So if b is 0, then xn is axn minus 1 mod m, which is the same as the multiplicative LCG. That's why this one is more general than the previous one just discussed. So it has one additional parameters, B also. In earlier one, we had two parameters, A and M. Here, B is also another parameter. So obviously, this is also going to decide about the effectiveness of random number generator. So now let's do an example. So xn is axn minus 1 plus B mod M. A is 13, B is 0, M is 2 raised to power 6. So if I take different seed values, then obviously I'll get different sequence. Although I fixed A, B and C, but if I vary my seed value X0, then I'll get a different sequence of random numbers. So various seed values, the values are shown here in the table. So x0 is 1. Look at the first column. The first column is simply I. That's just the serial number of the, that's the index of the random number. But you look for the second column, x0 is 1. So seed is chosen to be 1. So you can see the values are 1, 13, 41, 21, 17, 29. So it's easy to do the calculation. So it's, the first value is obviously going to be 1. The second value is 1 into 13 mod 2 raised to power 6. So that's mod 64. So that's 13 and so on. So you just keep on doing the operation and get the sequence. And you can see at the 16th value, I'm getting to see a repetition in the first case. Because again, I get a 1. So from this point, the sequence is going to repeat itself. Similarly, in the second column, for x not equal to 2, you get a different sequence of random numbers. For x not equal to 3, you get a different, and for x not equal to 4, you get a different one. And you can see all of their periods are different. Like x not equal to 1 and x not equal to 3 are better in comparison to 2 and 4 because their periods are longer. So this example is to show you that if the seed is different, although all other parameters are same, but still we are going to get a different sequence of random numbers. And it's not only about getting different values, it's about the other properties are also altered. So seed plays an important role, but unfortunately there is no as such a theoretical way of determining that with this seed it is always going to work or that particular seed is never going to work. So there's not enough a unified theory. There can be a theory for some specific operators or generator algorithms, but there's no general theory which can help you to decide that you have to select this seed value. But as I just told you, some theoretical analysis has definitely been done in this direction by number theorists, which are able to produce some results about on the selection of these parameters A, B, M. That how you can choose wisely your A, B, and M so that you have eventually a good random number generator sequence. So that's it. This is just what I've told you. Seed value affects the period of the generator. So how to select parameters? Period of LCG cannot be larger than N. So obviously if you look at the formula, so whatever number is coming, you are dividing by M and taking the remainder. So obviously remainder always comes less than the divisor. So the period is never going to be, so this is about the period. Period cannot be larger than M. It's definitely true because we have seen in examples also, and it's very easy to prove because the number of random numbers, the numbers which are less than equals to M, they are the only numbers present because the remainder is always going to be less than equal to M. So even if all the numbers come into the list, still you have the period is going to be less than that. This point has been explained in this example, in the previous example which I just discussed. In that example, we took M equals to 5 and the period was coming out to be 4. So ideally, M should be chosen as large as possible because period has to be very, very large. Otherwise, that algorithm is of no use. So M has to be very, very large. So now has the theorem by Hull and Dobell given by these two people in 1962, which tells you something about how to select parameters. So it says the linear congruential operator or generator, you can say this one, has maximum period if and only if the following three conditions are satisfied. So now this theorem is telling us certain conditions on A, B, and M. The condition will not be on the seed value because you give a different seed, you get a different sequence, but the condition is on the controlling parameter. So that's A, B, and M. So they are saying the operator is going to have a maximum period because this is desirable. We are looking for that. I need a generator algorithm which has a period as large as possible. So obviously if you are dividing with M, so period cannot be greater than M. So the maximum period is M only, right? So you get the maximum period if and only if. If and only if means whatever three conditions I'll tell you, these work both ways. If three conditions are satisfied, then you get the maximum period. And if you get the maximum period, then definitely those three conditions are by default true. So let's look at what are those three conditions. The first condition is M and B should be co-prime, means GCD of M and B should be equals to 1. So they should not have any common factor. M and B, they are co-prime. Second condition says Q is a prime and Q divides M. This should imply Q q also divides a minus 1. Third condition is 4 divides m should imply 4 divides a minus 1. So these are the three conditions. So second condition means if q is a prime, that means if you are able to find a prime which is a factor of m, then it should also be a factor of a minus 1. It should also divide a minus 1. And similarly, if 4 is a factor of m, then 4 should also divide a minus 1. So if these three conditions you are able to satisfy, you give me a combination of a, m and b which satisfies these three conditions, then definitely that LCG is going to have the maximum period. So let's understand them. All these conditions are satisfied if m is 2 raised to power k, a is 4c plus 1 and b is odd, where c, b and k all are positive integers. So now the theorem told us that if you are able to find such combination of a, b and m, then this is going to be best choice. Now this is an answer to the theorem that if we take this m, a and b, then definitely all the conditions are satisfied and then it will be forming a good LCG with a maximum period. So now let's see how this particular choice of m, a and b. M is 2 raised to power something. 2 raised to power, obviously that something is integer. And it should be as large as possible. A is of the type 4c plus 1. Because 4 divides a minus 1, from that this condition is coming. And b should be odd. So m is 2 raised to power k and b is odd. So clearly m is even and b is odd. So we know that even and odd number never have any common factors between them. And since k greater than equals to 2, it implies 4 divides m. And if a is 4c plus 1 also tells 4 divides a minus 1. So the third condition is also satisfied. The only prime dividing m is 2. Because it's 2 raised to power k. So only prime dividing m is 2 and 2 divides a minus 1 because 4 is dividing a minus 1. So this also tells us that second condition is also satisfied. So there's no, it's not a proof, but it's just a conviction that okay, if you take this choice of m, a and b, then these three conditions are satisfied. So if they are satisfied, so this means with this choices you will get a good linear congruential generator. So now I've taken this choice, m is 2 raised to power 13, a is 21 and b is 5. See, b I have taken odd, m I have taken 2 raised to power k, and then k can be as large as possible, so I have taken 13. And a should be like, according to this, a should be 4c plus 1. So it should be a multiple of 4 something plus 1. So you can take a as 5 because that's 4 plus 1. You can take a as 9 because that is 4 into 2, 8 plus 1. So whatever are the multiples of 4, you just add 1. Those are the possible values of a. So it can be 13, it can be 17, it can be 21. So whatever, there are infinitely many choices. I took a equals to 21. So if you want to generate the sequence, so this will be the formula. Xn is 21, xn minus 1 plus 5 mod 2 raised to power 13. So this is a full period generator. Full period means has a maximum period. So what is the period of this algorithm or generator? This is m, which is 2 raised to power 13, 8, 1, 9, 2. So this kind of examples we can test in lab because manually to do calculations with such large values of m won't be possible. So we can do these calculations in lab and you can actually verify for various other examples also that theorem, whatever is the claim of that theorem, that is true. So the conclusion of studying all these things is that even the random number generation algorithms, whatever are we studying. There are plenty more. We have studied just two, mid square and linear one. Even if you study or develop a new random number generator algorithm, that simply cannot be random. That any formula comes in your mind and you just fit it to give a sequence of random numbers, it's not going to work that way. You have to have a strong mathematical background supporting your algorithm, supporting your generator. Just like this theorem was telling you so many things. So in the next lecture, we are going to learn what is simulation. So that's all about random number generation algorithms. More we'll be seeing in the lab part. So in the next lecture, we are going to look at simulation.